really encourage you to continue to connect even after this is over. And those relationships can be a fuel during those dark valleys. So thank you for being here, especially if you have kids. It seems so easy. Oh, let's go to a conference. It'll be fun. And you disrupt their schedule. They have expectations. You're not in your home turf. And it can be so hard. And so I know that. And so just want to say a special thanks for you with kids. We have a fun van out there, and years ago I got some wheels and tires from California. They shipped them out, not in a box, just kind of with two round cardboard pieces strapped to the tire rims. And my son was, I don't know, five or so, and so I'm like, hey, let's unwrap them. And so I give him a utility knife, and I'm like, let's go. And he just starts doing this, you know what I mean? And I'm like, instantly I'm kind of like, yeah. And the Lord quickly reminded me, you asked him to help. So scratched the rims a little bit, but it's an old van, didn't matter. But in that moment, I was just grateful I didn't freak out. And I have freaked out in other situations, but that one I didn't. And so my phrase I got in my head is just, there's grace for that. There's grace for that. And just a couple months ago, my other son, we have this property with a fence, and you take two panels down, and there's a 4x4 post just stuck in the dirt. You got to wrestle it up so you can drive in the backyard, cut trees down and stuff. Anyway, that wasn't coming out. And so he's a strong guy. He just grabs this 4x4 and just starts going and breaks it off below grade. So how am I going to get this thing out that's stuck under? And I just said, well, there's grace for that. We'll come back. And anyway, so I just encourage you with little kids to just kind of, you know, there's grace for that. They're in the middle of their redemptive arc, right? And we're all growing, and so that's kind of fun. So, Philip, I love your story, your T-shirt story. That's awesome. It's got meaning. I think I saw this cool shirt down in town. I might go buy it and wear it at my church. It says, I love weed. Might be misunderstood, but it's true. I love you all. All right. Well, we're going to take a look here. We're moving through our deal. Times of refreshing comes in God's presence. We've seen that. We recognize and respond his goodness. We experience grace. We extend that grace. We grow and change instead of, you know, kind of pointing to everybody else that's messed up like Adam did. We integrate that work in our lives, walking with God. We're the same people wherever we go, whether we're in prison or vice president or anywhere in between, which I think is most of us between those two. Today, we're going to take a look at kingdom versus comfort. And it's a super, we're going to be going through Psalm 73. I love this psalm. It's my favorite psalm. It's okay if it's your favorite also. It's not just mine. So times of refreshing come through spending time in God's presence, allowing him to change our perspective about our lives and all we own and all we don't own, as he shifts our focus from our comfort to his kingdom. All right? So it gives us a new perspective. All right? New perspective. Have you ever had an experience that was so profound, positive, painful, negative, whatever, that just kind of you remember that and it shifted how you interpret and see things? I've hitchhiked a bunch, and usually if you're hitchhiking, there's backstory, something broke. But I went to, I think, Tennessee once for a conference, and I'm like, I kind of want adventure. I don't want to just go there, rent a car. So I UPS'd my mountain bike down there. For some reason, I deflated the tires to pack it all in a box. And I'm saving money, so I'm at this super, super shady hotel. And I get there, and to get there, though, I'm supposed to get there Saturday, but I'm in St. Louis at a connecting flight, and this is funny. I was in the middle of my doctoral program, and I had this final project where you have to read this whole story, and you're a consultant, you have to write all this stuff. So I'm sitting there at the gate doing this. I'm reading and writing and thinking, and I look up. Everybody's gone, even the lady behind the little booth. Somehow, first boarding, military, second boarding, old people, third boarding, young people, all of it. And I'm like, and so I find somebody like, where's the plane? She's like, it's gone. So I have to spend the night in St. Louis. So now I get into whatever, I'm going to Tennessee Sunday night and I forgot to bring a pump for my tires. And so the conference is Monday morning, and it's Sunday night. I got nothing, so I go to the hotel manager, who seriously looks like Santa Claus. Big, fat guy, overalls, big white beard. I'm like, dude, I need a bike pump. He's like, well, there ain't none around here. I go, well, where's Walmart? It's like 4 miles down the road. So I start walking, and it's nighttime. And I walk down this road, and I get out of a couple, you know, convenience store things, and I'm in the country. And this road is, it's a paved road, but there is no shoulder. It's just straight down and straight up. It's dark. I'm walking on this road, my thumb's out. And I have never felt so alone and dejected and rejected as car by car goes by. And it occurred to me, nobody is thinking, oh, there's a young Christian from a Christian university. You just don't assume that. And it kind of sensitized me when I see somebody. I'm like, I wonder what the backstory is. And now and then I'll pick somebody up. But, you know, obviously you got to be careful with that. So there's other stories. My son was driving in Omaha, and there's this overpass. It's curved. It's wintertime. And so he spun out. He's got a 94 Jeep, not a Jeep, a Toyota Land Cruiser that he loves to work on. And so he wrecked the bumper, and so he had to make a new one. So there he is wrecking the bumper. But now every time anybody in our family goes around that corner, we're like, be careful. You know what I mean? Because it's an event. Another time when Jesse was younger, he had a Jeep. And he bought with his own money, which means it was economical, which means some things would break. So we're in the Badlands in South Dakota, just going around the middle of nowhere, and we got stuck. And this is really weird clay mud, really, really stuck. And so we finally got out, and then we're in the middle of nowhere, and something breaks, and it doesn't run. And so we are, I mean, there's no cell reception for miles and miles. And so my younger son and I, we hitchhike. We just walk and walk and walk to the nearest paved road. We start doing this again, and people go by. And you just feel so rejected. And finally, I turned. I'm walking backwards, facing the people. I'm like, you're going to have to look at me if you're going to pass me up. All right? And so a couple on a motorcycle stops. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, it's not helpful. But we talk a little bit, and then they leave. And so finally a car pulls up, and I don't know what it is, but whenever I'm hitchhiking, Native American Indians who are drunk pick me up. That's just kind of the way it is. And so this couple picks me up. She's driving. He's either high or drunk, but he's out of it. And they drive us 30 miles all the way to our tent, which is also in the middle of nowhere. I'm like, this is amazing. So, you know, the verse in Hebrews about entertaining angels, like, I don't think the angels would be drunk. I'm just saying. Anyway, so that's the story there. We have these events and these memories, and they form pictures of us, and they change our perspective. That's changed my perspective of hitchhikers, at least some compassion and occasional interaction with them instead of just, you know, a flying by. So I'm going to tell you a story. Actually, Asaph is going to tell you his story. He had an experience that fundamentally shifted his perspective. He was envious. You ever been envious? Yeah, when I lived in Omaha, one of our places, guy down the road won a Harley-Davidson motorcycle. I'm not really a Harley guy, but I'm like, Lord, him? He's not making sacrifices for your kingdom? What is that? I mean, I was honestly wrapped around the axle and frustrated. Seriously, like 5 or 10 minutes, I got over it. But the thought occurred to me. What is going on with that, right? So we're going to go to Psalm 73, and it's interesting how this psalm starts and how it ends, but I got to show you this whole thing. It looks like the computer messed up. It didn't. So in Hebrew, there's this letter ki, or chi. It's an X, and so you can kind of see half of that indention thing. So this is called a chiastic structure, where these Hebrew people, they would have thoughts, and they would proceed in some kind of lot. I don't have to shout anymore. Some kind of logical order, and they get to the middle, which is typically the central, most important part, and then they would back up, and the thoughts, as you go point by point, mirror the similar thought above. And so you can see what I'm saying. The very first one, God is good, kind of, but I have some issues, and he go down at the bottom, God's presence is all he needs, and in the middle, the turning point, God, time in God's presence gave him a new perspective. So we're going to go through the psalm here, and I'll walk you through that. But he starts with, God is good, but I have issues. I have questions. I have problems. And then it ends, but as for me, God's presence is all I need. And that's a beautiful place. We're ending the conference with the value of God's presence. We started the conference with God, time in God's presence, right? Responding to his goodness. His presence is all I need. And so that's where we're at. So let's kick it off here, okay? Yeah, between verse 1 and 28, he almost walked away from God. That is interesting. So verse 1, get your phones, your Bibles, whatever you got there, Psalm 73. Verse 1, truly, God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. And so he's writing, it almost, I mean, if he's saying God is good, it's almost though as he's considered the alternative, that he's struggled and he's maybe asked the question, is God good? And if God is good, how come these people get what they get and don't get what they don't get, okay? So he's concluding now, after this is all over, God is good. But he says, my feet almost slipped. Look at verse 2. But as for me, this is the but part, but as for me, my feet almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped. If you're walking, Donna was just reading something about Black Butte Trail and how it's unmanaged, and there's a wire retaining wall that's collapsing and is dangerous, and so your feet could slip on that trail, I guess. I haven't been up there. But anyway, so he's on a path, and his feet almost slip. And so you have this idea that not just his feet are slipping, but he's on a path, and every path leads to a certain destination, right? If you take a certain path, it goes to a place. It's not going to take you to a different place than the path goes to, right? If I get on I-80 and I go east, I'm eventually going to hit Omaha. I'm never going to hit Honolulu. It's just the path doesn't go there, okay? And yet some people choose a path, and that path goes to an inevitable destination, and they get there, and they freak out. It's bad. It's full of disaster and pain, and God doesn't love me. And it's like, dude, you picked the path. It's interesting, isn't it? Okay, so moving on here. He is on the path of, despair is where you end up when we think we know the end of the story. And I love that quote because we don't know the end of the story, right? We don't know tomorrow. So therefore, the very thing that causes us to freak out about the future is in itself evidence for hope. Because we do not know what will happen, there is hope that God can come in and speak to us in that. And again, so often we have that dark, depressing mental movie. Oh, it's all bad. So not all bad, okay? So when you are, do you know yourself well? Do you know yourself? Do you go to despair? Remember, what happens to you? Okay, something bad happens. Well, what does that trigger? Where do you go with that? And so here are four things we really skillfully need to watch our hearts and watch how we respond to either temptation or how we respond to stress and trials and things like that. It's just called halt. When you're hungry, angry, lonely, or tired, then you need to be extra careful with yourself. It's just, we're physical beings, right? We'd love to be beyond all that, but if you're tired and hungry, hangry, we have to be smart about that. And I remember when I got married, I didn't know myself that well, and Don would be like, John, you need to eat. I'm like, why? You're a little, I'm like, okay. Or John, you need to go for a bike ride. So that's the benefit of marriage, right? Anyway, and there's others. All right, so we're moving on here. Go to the third one, insecurity, verse 3. Okay, God is good, but my feet almost slipped, verse 3, because I was envious of the arrogant. I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Now, that word prosperity is shalom. I saw the shalom of the wicked. They have peace. They have ease. I'm over here sacrificing, getting all banged up and working hard for this whole righteousness thing. And what is this? The righteous, the wicked, they have shalom, and I don't. Frustrated. Well, here's a proverb that I love. The prudent see danger and take refuge, but the simple keep going and suffer for it. He's tired of taking refuge. And he sees an exception. Sometimes the wicked don't suffer for it. Proverbs always have exceptions, right? Okay. So the word saw, I saw, means to study and to examine. And so he is fixed and stuck on, why do the wicked get what I don't get? Why do they get what I want? Why did he get the Harley? They're stuck on that. Okay. He's studying that. He's examining that. So envy is typical a result of us studying and focusing and looking at something, and we just don't let it go, and we don't see where it's taking them, and that's coming up, okay? So, next one, D, desiring the comfort and prosperity of the wicked. 4 through 12, he rolls through this and he describes, it's not a very pretty picture, verse 4, they have no pangs until death. That is, they have no pains and frustrations. Their bodies are fat and sleek. It's not a slam. He's simply saying they're flourishing and they're healthy in this culture. Verse 5, they're not in trouble as others are. They're not stricken like the rest of mankind. They're free from troubles because they have money and they have power. Verse 6, therefore their pride is their necklace. Violence covers them as a garment. These people are wealthy and powerful, and violence and pride characterize them. And he's looking at that going, they're getting some good stuff, and I'm not. Everything about them seems to go counter to wisdom literature. The righteous are blessed. The righteous have a good life. The wicked suffer. He's like, not in this case, and I'm kind of tired of it, all right? So envy blinds us. It's not really true, right, that these people have it made. There's one little phrase. Look at this, verse 4. They have no pangs until death. Okay, then it's a whole other deal at that point, okay? So I want to enter into Asaph's life here and say, Asaph, come over here, buddy. Okay, time out. Everyone's fighting a battle. You don't see the battles that they're fighting. It looks like they're fine, but inside, they're not. I remember driving. I used to live 20 miles away from school, and I'd ride my motorcycle on I-80 all the way out to where we lived. And I would see sometimes, you know, occasionally a Ferrari or a super nice, you know, whatever. And I was just aware of my assumptions, like the hitchhiking thing. I would look at this car and think, oh, wow, he's got it made, or is his home life just pain and broken? I just didn't know, right? And I was quick to check my assumptions. And then I'm like, maybe he's a retired missionary and he's giving millions away, and this is just a super economical, I don't know, okay? I don't know. So it's just fun to check our automatic assumptions when we see certain things, like hitchhikers and Ferraris. Maybe if you have a Ferrari, you should pick up a hitchhiker. The things we learn at the conference, right? I've got to write that down. All right, so Asaph, everyone's fighting a battle, and Asaph, it's a lie from Satan that everyone else is happier than you. That's a lie. Just call it what it is. Asaph, you're comparing yourself to people that you really don't want to be like. All right? So want to talk to Asaph. There was a poll a while ago taken by 5,000 middle-class single and married men and women asking them about singleness and marriage. And check this out. The single people were no more or less happy than the married people. The married people were no more or less happy than the single people. But then it got weird. Single people envied the married people, and the married people envied the single people. Seriously, this is the results. Many married people revealed they were happy because they were supposed to be happy because they're married, not because they had feelings of happiness. A single woman said, I envy my friend Jane. She's really happy. She has a husband and kids, a home. She has everything. The married woman said, I envy Connie. She has it made. She's free to come and go when and where she wants. Her time is her own. Her money is her own. She's out in the world doing things. She has everything. She's the happy one. Isn't that interesting? How wherever we are, it's so natural to look over the fence and envy other people who are in a different position without knowing the details of their lives. It's always a superficial thing, right? Yeah. Asaph, everyone's fighting in a battle, and just because they have what you think they have doesn't really make it better. I love this quote. A change in geography will never make up for a flaw in character. My wife and I, we love Utah, Moab, Utah. We go there, mountain bike a bunch, and we've been lost there a whole bunch of times. He picked up hitchhiker and hitchhiked. Anyway, so what would I say Moab, Utah, because that's kind of my escape. I mean, I think if I could take my mountain bike and go to Moab, Utah for like 6 or 7 months, everything would be okay. And it wouldn't be, because I take my junk with me, right? And so what would you put in the blank? You know, a change in zip code. Wait, is that going to fix your heart? A change in in-laws. Okay, now we're getting low. Oh, you know, what? It's us that the Lord needs to deal with. It's not always this external stuff. Okay, so comparing ourselves with others, it usually doesn't work. So let's go to verse 7. their eyes swell out through fatness. Again, he's not insulting them. He's simply saying they have an excess. Their hearts overflow with follies. The Hebrew literally says their eye has gone out from fat. So they're just, maybe they're eating so much, they're indulging so much, they're just puffy and they're, you know what I mean? Kind of a interesting description. So their luxurious, violent living has dimmed their soul. That's what he's getting at, okay? Verse 8, they scoff and they speak with malice. Loftily, they threaten opposition. And so again, violence. They have the ability, they have the resources, and they have the skill to hurt you. And they will not hesitate to do so. And Asaph is like, what's up with that? Where's my protection? How come they have all that power, all that prestige, and all that social influence? Okay? Verse 9, they set their mouths against the heavens. Their tongues struts through the earth. So they're verbally arrogant. All right? It's like they control the whole world. Verse 10, therefore his people turn back to them. They find no fault in them. So they're popular. No one criticizes them. They just have this massive following, and they run for mayor, and they get elected, and there's corruption everywhere, and no one seems to care. And how come they keep making progress? Social control and social power. And so here's what Timothy, right? The love of money is the root of all evils. Some people, in reaching for it, have strayed from the faith and stabbed themselves with many pains or pangs. The same kind of word here. So it's that love and that pursuit that these bulging out fat people, powerful people, that love of that, it's going to come back and hurt. But there just happens to be, you know, a bunch of decades between they're sowing those seeds and reaping what they inevitably will reap. And that's where we live in the middle, and it's frustrating, right? Verse 11. They say, how can God know? Is there knowledge of the Most High? How does God know what we do? Sell me the cigarettes. Who's going to know? Remember that kid? Sell me. Who's going to know? Well, yeah, God's going to know. All right? They have this view of God that he's way out there and completely disconnected. Behold, these are the wicked. Verse 12, always at ease. They increase in riches. Wow. Shalom. They have shalom. Things are not supposed to be this way. Why aren't they being punished? Because we got verses. People like this should be tripping and stumbling and falling and not the righteous, right? And so we go here to the next one. Frustration, lack of wealth and power. Look at verse 13. This is really, I can relate to this. In vain I have kept my heart clean and washed my hands in innocence. You ever feel like that? You're sacrificing, you're working, you're devoted, you don't do things, you do things, and you're like, I'm just tired of this. What is this all? And then I look out the window, and they're living the life that I wish I had on the surface, right? We don't know. Okay, but you see, in vain I've kept my heart clean. So sometimes we do the things we do. Like, you know, when I ride my motorcycle, I got the gear, the boots, the helmet, and when I was a kid, I grew up riding motorcycles. I remember one time I crashed. I was sliding along the ground long enough to be aware of the noise of the ground sliding on my head, on my helmet, and I thought, I'm glad I have a helmet. So ever since then, like, I'm wearing a helmet. When I go rock climbing, we use ropes because sometimes you fall. You know what I mean? Gun safety is a real thing. Parachute buckles, double check them. I mean, this is good advice, right? So, but sometimes we take these precautions, usually in less extreme things, and we're like, is it really important? You know, seat belts, flossing, really? Is my life going to end if I skip a day? Okay, whatever it may be. Investing for the future, these kind of wisdom things. So I led canoe wilderness trips in northern Wisconsin for 2 summers, 5-day trips. I lived out of just a little bucket of stuff. And we'd go and lead these youth trips. The first trip, because it's not backpacking, you can pack a cooler full of really good food. And I would make a fire. And for the first meal, we had pork chops, frozen pork chops. And so every student, high school student, we get 2 pork chops. So a group of 15, I'm cooking 30 pork chops of fire out in the middle of nowhere, Wisconsin. I'll never forget the first, we had our training trip, and I don't really know what I'm doing, but the first trip, it's raining on the first night, and I got to cook pork chops in the rain. So I get some kind of lean-to. I take my big knife and shove it in the dirt, tie off a tether, and get this tarp, and I'm out there trying to make this fire. And I had some white gas, so you know you're helping. This kid comes out and stands right next to me and says, "We're never going to eat. It's never going to work." I'm like, and so the more he said that, the more like, I'm going to get this fire going. So I got the fire going, and we cooked, and it worked, and I proved my point. But so I do this for 2 years. We eat the pork chops, and we always had to burn the bones in the fire because there's bears all over the place, right, like here, right? And so, but the very last trip of my second summer, I was tired of doing the right thing. I had grown weary of that. And so we had our pork chops, and I'm like, bears aren't going to be coming around. Just throw them in the little park service trash can. So 30 pork chop bones in, right? And then we pack up, we go, we head down river. Well, the next night, another group from the same camp stayed, another group leader that I know and work with stayed in that same camp, and bears came in and just ripped the place apart. And we get back to camp, and he's like, "I wonder which trip leader didn't burn his 30 pork chop bones. Like, that's not a normal thing." I'm like, "Why bears anyway?" So that, to me, that story just highlights the need. We do the little important things every day, and they add up. The aggregate is huge. Remember, we are the sum total of many small decisions over many small days. I think one of the most valuable gifts God has given us is the little moments. We invest in little moments today and then tomorrow. You guys do athletics? You ever run? I've run 2 marathons, and we love, endurance stuff. And so you just do a little bit here, a little bit there. You train here, you train there. And after weeks and months, all of a sudden, you're a different person. You invest in God's word. It doesn't have to be a 2-hour devotional. You don't have to quit your job. It can be a little bit today, a little bit tomorrow. And if you keep doing that, months and years go by, and all of a sudden, we are different people. So I love the concept of small decisions that build up. Okay, so he's tired of this, and he says, they have everything. Verse 15, he says, "If I said, I will speak this way, I would have betrayed the generation of your children. But when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me a wearisome task." He's like, I don't know what to do. I'm seeing them prosper. I'm tired of doing the right thing, but I can't say that. I mean, I know it's stupid to quit doing the right thing. What do I do? And then we're coming right back here, okay? It seemed like a wearisome task. And so we get to back to Psalm 23. The provision, the protection calls us to spend time in his presence. And that gives us to the turning point. Time in God's presence gives him a new perspective. This is where everything shifts, all right? He encountered the living God. In God's presence, he finally understands something that clicks. And he's like, okay, I got it. He's been frustrated. He's been envious of these people. They're on a path. He says, my feet almost slipped because I joined their path. I wanted to join their path, all right? Remember, every path leads to a destination. Look at verse 17. Well, let's go to 16. It seemed to me a wearisome task until I went into the sanctuary of God. Then I discerned their end. He knows their path leads to an inevitable destination. It's going to end there. And he's looking at where their path is ending, and he's like, oh, I'm in the sanctuary. I'm in the presence of God, a loving God who provides and protects. And they're on a different path, and their path ends in at that place. I don't want to end in that place, so I'm not going to be envious of the path that they're on that ends to that place. He was able to figure that the presence of God taught him that, okay? So change his perspective. When we're doing that, the Lord changes our hearts. Maybe we're envious of our neighbor with whatever they got, okay? And that's the Lord's work in our lives that can resolve that. It's not just a matter of saying, no, stop, don't do this, don't do that, which sometimes can help, but really we need the Lord's work, all right? The solution is to spend time in God's presence. Notice his change in perspective after the turning point. He has a new perspective on wealth and power. Look at verse 18. Truly, you set them in slippery places. See, I thought my feet were slipping, and I almost slipped because I was envying them, but you put their feet in slippery places. You make them fall to ruin. They're actually the ones that are at risk living in an unstable place. It looks like they've got it made, but they are not. Verse 19, how they are destroyed in a moment, swept away by sudden terrors. Why do I need to envy them? They're not headed to the place where I want to head. Let them go. Interesting. So time in God's presence has changed his perspective on wealth and power. Also changes his perspective on his desires, right? He's frustrated by the things they have. They have power, they have popularity, they have money, and he is lacking these things because he's been doing the right thing, keeping his heart clean. These things won't matter in the long run, and he has that eternal perspective because he spent time in God's presence. Verse 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, talking about his soul being embittered. Look at verse 25. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there's nothing on earth that I desire besides you. That's profound. Instead of fixating on what his neighbors have and what he doesn't have, he's focusing on the presence of God, saying, you are my treasure. You are what I value, you, and you are what I have. Are you content with who Jesus is for you right now? Or is it Jesus plus the boat, plus the cabin, plus the mountain bike, plus, you know what I'm saying? Okay. Time in God's presence changed his perspective on his ultimate desires, and that leads him to the next one. Perspective on security. God protects his heart. Verse 26. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. The NIV, so that's next. So he's my strength of my heart and my portion forever. It literally, the Hebrew is, God is the rock summit of my heart. Isn't that great? He's the rock summit of my heart. Strong, stronghold, stability, security. So time in God's presence has changed his perspective on security and also on stability. In verse 26, my flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. That last part, my portion forever, in verse 26, it gives me stability. The word is smoothness. So he gives me smoothness or stability. Kind of interesting concept, okay? So he's got a new perspective on his desires, on security, on stability, leading to contentment. A new perspective on contentment. Look at verse 28. But as for me, God's presence is all I need. I have made the sovereign Lord my shelter, as I declare all the things you have done. Look at this verse. God's presence is all I need. How did he get there? Because he lives in a world where other people are, it's tempting, believe this, believe that, want what they have. I have made the sovereign Lord my shelter. He did that. He actively owned his walk with the Lord, made it happen. It's not like, oh, well, I just, you know, good for you, spiritual person, you know, like Jesus stuff, but that's not me, because why not? Why not make him your shelter, okay? And this is the process, finding rest in his presence and looking at the destination of those that we would envy. And part of that process is declaring all the things he's done. The Lord did this for me. The Lord did that for me. Like my dad, I told you about his little journal, or not the whole long journal, but he had these lists. He would just write down God's grace to our family. You know, this happened here, and he was hitchhiking in California, and some guy picks him up, and he's like, well, what are you studying? Well, I want to go and teach VOAG. And the guy's like, you don't want to do that. You want to go into ag econ research. My dad never heard of this. He's like, okay. So he changes his major based on some guy that picked him up, goes off and get a master's anyway. So it's just like, you know, that changed the whole trajectory of his story, and he wrote that down. Maybe hitchhiking's like a thing in my family, right? It's just how God speaks to us. I don't know. All right. So when Jesus becomes our treasure, our perspective will change because he changes our heart, right? Because envying my neighbor's motorcycle, it's a heart issue. I'm not content, all right? And so contentment is a choice, and there's a lot of things we can do to facilitate our contentment, and finding joy in the presence of God is obviously one of them, all right? So, we spend time in his presence. God changes our perspective because he changes us, right? He changes our perspective on all that we own. Maybe we're holding on to things with tight hands and we open up our hands. Maybe changes our perspective on what we don't have. We think we need it, and then we realize I don't need that because he is all that we need. So I've often thought about a wedding. How weird would it be? We got a wedding, and the bride and the groom, you know, come down, and you do your who gives this person, and you go through this stuff, and at the point of the ring, do you have a ring to symbolize your love? And so, they dig out the ring, and the guy gives the ring to the bride, and at that point, I would have her mic'd up. It's a sermon illustration. She takes the ring, and she says, oh, I have wanted this ring for so long. And she just walks out saying, I've been dating this guy to get this ring and I finally got it. This is the happiest day of my life. And she just leaves. And everyone's like, what is going on? And yet that is how so many Christians treat Jesus. I got from him what I wanted. And we leave him at the altar wanting intimacy, wanting a relationship. So don't be that bride running out of the wedding with whatever he gives you, whether it's peace or blessing or whatever. Remember the over, under, for, from, that whole thing? Remember that? That's where we can go. So that is what we're asking. So what's stopping you from spending time in God's presence? I mean, it can happen. You can make the Lord your shelter. It takes a while to get building a relationship. But that is something that you can do. Spending time with him, walking with him, asking him about the people you envy. Where are they going? What would happen if I go there? Are my feet almost slipping? Am I going off the straight path onto the rocky, crooked path? What perspectives might need changing in your life? We live in a very opulent culture. So I would submit that our perspective on wealth and power probably 24/7 should be up for discussion in terms of what the Lord says about that, right? Desires? What are our desires? Security, stability, contentment? The big deals of the heart, right? And so as we zoom out and look at the whole conference week, time in God's presence is really where everything starts. And our motive for spending time in his presence is our response to his goodness, right? Recognize his goodness, respond to that. We experience his grace. We extend his grace. We're open to his work in our lives. It's not just everybody else that's screwed up, okay? And so he deals with, like a surgeon of the soul deals with our hearts, with our desires and our envy and who we look to and where we measure ourselves, and we can find a new perspective as we walk with Jesus in a very materialistic, very rich, very powerful, saturated world. We can be lights. We can be content and at ease with who we are and who Jesus is. And other people, they're just like, I gotta go, I gotta get more, And it's like, okay, there you go. Let's have coffee sometime. How's your life going? You know what I mean? Okay, so you know what I mean. So Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. It's a great story that Asaph expresses here. Had the courage to just be honest and say, yeah, I envied them. I was so frustrated because they're getting everything. I'm working hard. What is the point? The point is enjoying your presence, not joining them on the path to destruction. So whatever that looks like to us in our individual circumstances, we pray that you would become more clear and more clear as the object of our desire. So teach us to desire you more than other stuff. We love you. Thank you for this conference, for these people. We pray that you would continue, that your spirit would really work as we depart, go different destinations, and even back at our home churches and our own families, that we just trust and believe your spirit is in the middle of a great redemptive work. May we have the eyes to see it. May we have the patience to fan that flame of the Spirit of God in those situations. So we love you and thank you for what you are doing and what you will do. Amen.